writer of the Book of Lamentations was having a very bad week, it sounds like, but right in the middle of it is this one verse of great hope, which is the inspiration for our call to worship and our opening hymn today. Please join in the call to worship. The Lord's unfailing love and mercy never cease. Fresh is the morning, as sure as the sunrise. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Seeks communion with us. God cares about our worries and our concerns. God knows the burdens that weigh heavy in our hearts. Let us ask God to forgive us, that we might draw closer to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, the truth is there is plenty, but we choose to believe the myth of scarcity. And so we take more than our share. We exploit others, whether we know it or not, to satisfy our insatiable appetite. Lord, help us to see that we already have more than we need, and open our hearts toward those who have lost what little they have.
Thank you.
Friends, this is the good news. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He died for us. He rose again for us. He cleanses us and he redeems us. Friends, we are a forgiven people. Thanks be to God.
Welcome you to worship on this day at First Presbyterian Church. This time we send the pew pads down the row so that we can learn who our visitors are and also maybe remind ourselves who's sitting next to us. These remember the face, but sometimes not the name. So please fill out the pad as it comes by. If you are a visitor and would like to know more about the church, put your phone number and address there, and someone will contact you and give you a friendly visit, bring you a copy of the church video and a small gift, and be glad to tell you more about what a great church this is. We have red ribbons in one of the pew cards. If you pin that on, then we'll know for sure to extend to you the right hand of fellowship and give you the official First Presbyterian welcome. I'd like to call your attention to a couple other cards in the pew rack. One is the prayer request card, the lavender one. If you have a prayer request, you may fill that out and either put it in the offering plate, or if it's more confidential, there's a prayer box back in the narthex back here, and it's locked. You can put it in there. And our confidential list of prayers, we'll get right to work on that this week. The card that should be in the front is the Stephen Ministry card, reminding you we're a Stephen Ministry congregation, and you can put a request in there if you'd like to talk to me about a need you have or someone you know who could use a Stephen minister. And let me remind you something that we get the requests for periodically, and it's quite easy to do. If you would prefer a Stephen minister from another congregation, if you'd feel more comfortable talking to someone who doesn't know you so well, that's understandable, and that's just fine. We do that all the time, so that's something we can work out for you if you like. I hope there aren't that many reservation cards in there. I hope everybody has turned in a dinner reservation card for next Sunday. You know, it's kind of the double whammy there. Not only is the grand finale of our spiritual enrichment weekend, and it'll be something that everybody can do around the table, children, old folks, whether you're a family of one or a family of 10. And also, it's the official welcoming for our new interim pastor, Leighton Mose III. So I hope everybody will come to that. If you've been to the Wednesday lunch, you know when Martha Crisp does the food, it is marvelous. But she's going to need to know whether to prepare for 20 or 200. So fill out those meal cards if you'd like to make a reservation for you and your family for next Sunday right after church. People say we don't have enough fellowship dinner, so we got a big one next Sunday. Also, turn in that card if you come to a men of the church tomorrow night to hear the speaker there. Glad you're here to worship with us this Lord's Day. Thank you.
Let us pray. Guide us, O God, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover your peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson this morning is from 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 8 through 16. Hear now God's word to us. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "Go now to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and live there. For I have commanded a widow there to feed you." So he set out and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said, but first make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the jar will not be emptied and the jug of oil will not fail until the day that the Lord sends forth rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so that she as well as he and her household ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by Elijah. This is the word of the Lord.
Normally when we read scripture on our own or listen to it read by Kathy in church, we're trying to get the teaching. What's the message of God? What's the lesson to be learned? But there are other ways to read scripture spiritually, called Lectio Divina or the Ignatian method. There are others. One way to do that would be to get the Spiritual Formation Bible that helps, has some articles and helps lead you through that. Or to come to our workshop this Saturday morning where Janine Wiseman, a certified spiritual director, will lead us through spiritual reading of the text to help us to hear God's word to us today, God's word speaking to us, or to perhaps to hear ourselves in the story. Certainly this is a very familiar story from Mark's gospel. As Jesus taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance, say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. And he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance. But she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I've gotten to play with the handbell choir a few times. I can read music, but about all I know about the actual ringing of the bells is what Ralph Dearborn was able to teach me in a couple of practice sessions. You can always tell the new person in the handbell choir. That's the one sitting there going, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. You know, I mean, you lose your place. You were dead. So when I'm listening to the handbell choir on Sundays, for some reason my eye is normally drawn to Fran Smith, who plays the high bells, first of all, which is the hardest to play. The notes are written above the scale. It's hard to read the music. And Fran generally has two in each hand. How she can ring one, but the other one doesn't ring, I don't know. but she makes it look easy and joyful. I'm reminded of what our preaching professor taught us. That he said how important your facial expression is in communication. He said, when you preach about heaven, your face should light up. They should see heaven in your face. Now, when you preach about hell, well, then your regular face will do. So I don't know which face to use today. Is this story in Mark's gospel about generosity, gracious and joyful giving? Or is it an indictment for those who are giving for the wrong reasons in the wrong way? Is it a story about the true measure of faith and trust? Or is it a story about justice and injustice, sickness and health? Actually, I think it may be one of Jesus' and then what happened stories. Now that this widow has demonstrated her full trust in God, she has given all she has to God, she has put herself in God's hand, what happens next? Jesus apparently is the only one with the eyes to see her, the only one who noticed her plight. Who will have Jesus' eyes outside the temple? Whose caring, compassionate face will she see? So this is a sermon entitled Jesus' Eyes, and I hope it'll be more of a heavenly sermon so I can smile. So you won't have to say to me what one of Will Be Dunn's parishioners said to him in the Kudzu comic strip recently. She said, "Preacher, I really appreciated you telling us what hell is like." I says, "I didn't preach on that topic." She says, "Well, it wasn't what you said so much as how you said it." I guess this story of the widow's mite is some people's favorite passage. I mean, if you're a literalist, say, "Hey, I put in 2 cents. Jesus said that was great." You remember the old Scottish pastor who admonished his congregations, "Some of you have been putting pennies in the collection plate." I mean, not pennies, buttons. You've even been putting buttons. If you're going to do that, at least use your own buttons. Don't take them off the pew cushions. After the 8:30 service, two people told me this morning they found loose buttons on there, so they put them in the plate. This brief story in Mark's succinct gospel begins with Jesus blasting the scribes who want to be seen as being rich and powerful. He says they devour widows' houses. In other words, they take whatever they can from whomever they can for their own gain. And when they come to the temple, they make a big show about, "Look what I'm putting in the pot." And then who comes along but one of the widows, the kind that they devour? And she puts in her 2 small copper coins. It was all she had. Some interpreters suggest that Jesus is attacking both the scribes and this religious system that has taught this woman to offer her tiny coins as though God would demand such sacrifices from the poor of the world. I thought about that all week, and I finally decided that if Mark were trying to make that point, if he thought that's what Jesus was trying to teach, I think Mark would have worded it differently. He probably would have used his favorite word, immediately. He might have said, "Jesus was watching these showboaters who take advantage of everybody they can, make a big deal about dropping in their large contributions, when who should appear immediately but one of those widows they had gouged. And Jesus said, 'Look what they have wrought.'" Now, true, these scribes may be the reason she is poor, but I think the main teaching here is about faith and wellness. As much as Jesus talks about healing in the Gospels, this may be another story about sickness and health. The sick are those who have an addiction. They have to get money at any cost so they can make themselves feel important, so they can try to impress others in the temple. Whereas the one who is well is the widow. She demonstrates great faith. And how many times does Jesus say, "Your faith has made you well"? Perhaps she has a place to stay. Hospitality was the rule of the land, and it's certainly the custom of the time. She could glean from her neighbor's garden or vineyard, so perhaps she had food to eat. Maybe her basic needs were provided. Maybe she was humming to herself on the way to temple that day, "Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided." Now all she has are these two coins. Not even 2 cents, just worth half a cent each. What can you buy for a penny? Well, she bought some joy. She could give to God, and she gave a pretty impressive gift. All she had, the 100% tithe. I see her as the living example of what Jesus teaches just 10 verses earlier, the great commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Contrast that with these upwardly mobile scribes who put some of their ill-gotten gain in the basket to show how important they are. Was there really joy in that? What if you drop $1,000 in the plate and the next person puts in $2,000? So much for your moment of glory. They weren't really giving joyfully. They weren't giving out of gratitude, out of response to God's love. They weren't even trying to impress God. They were trying to impress the other guys. That's usually not a happy thing. Or at best, it's short-lived. You may have guys like that at your office who are trying to show how important they are, how to create the impression that they are irreplaceable. Well, that's a mistake. You don't want to be irreplaceable, because if you can't be replaced, you can't be promoted. Perhaps there's some consolation for those misdirected egos. Yeah. Maybe their sole purpose in life is to serve as a warning to others. I used to work with a newsman, Dave Collins, who liked to say his favorite expression over and over again. He said, if you can't be the most likable, be the most disgusting. There's just as much distinction. Well, the one person in this gospel story who is healthy, who is strong of faith, is the widow. And only she can truly experience the true joy of giving. It's one of those things you can't explain to someone who's never experienced it. But it's a great joy to give when you're giving to God. I enjoy writing out my check to First Presbyterian Church or Union Theological Seminary. The one that grates on me is that check that keeps getting larger each month to Time Warner Cable. You know? Only during ACC basketball season is it worth it having ESPN and Fox Sports Now. Although I've rationalized maybe if Jeannie weren't at home watching A&E, which she likes, she might be out doing something more expensive. But the truth is, when we're giving to God, there is a joy in giving. The woman is able to give generously because of her trust in God. She knows the truth of what Hubert Altman says every Wednesday at Early Birds: you can't outgive God. Hubert knows that because he practices that. So do you suppose that widow left the temple that day singing, as we will today, if thou but trust in God to guide thee? But then what happened? What happened to the widow after she put her full trust in God and gave God all the money she had? When she went back out on the street, who had eyes to see her? Since only Jesus saw her in the temple, who had Jesus' eyes? And even if we have Jesus' eyes, how do we do justice for the widow, for the needy ones? We can care for them one-on-one. We can marshal other forces to them as a group, perhaps as a church. But is that like being that mountain rescue squad you may have heard about, where there was this terrible curve up on this mountain road, and quite often people wouldn't make the curve, and they'd crash over the side, and sometimes they'd crash all the way to the bottom of the mountain, so often that the rescue squad actually blazed a trail down there at the bottom so they could get their rescue vehicles in. Finally, one day, they're down there rescuing somebody, and they look up to the top of that cliff and say, maybe it would help if we built a guardrail up there. Yeah. How do we help the widows to keep them from becoming poor? How do we alleviate the conditions that impoverish widows? We haven't solved that conundrum yet. But our presbytery took an interesting step last month. We voted in favor of a resolution from Rick Brand's church in Henderson that urges companies to limit CEOs' financial compensation to 200 times that of the average salary of the average employee of the company. If this should be passed by the General Assembly next year in Richmond and then voted in favor of by the majority of presbyteries, it might produce some change. At first, I was skeptical about that. Well, whoop-de-doo, Presbyterians are against overcompensation of CEOs. Who cares? But we can do something, because we Presbyterians, through our Presbyterian Foundation and others, we own stock in a lot of companies. And as stockholders, we're allowed to go to the shareholder meetings, and we can make this a resolution from the floor that they limit the compensation of CEOs. Once upon a time, that ratio of CEO compensation to the employee was in the ratio of 40 to 1. To give you an example, if the average staff person here at First Presbyterian State made $25,000, then the senior pastor could not be paid more than $1 million annually. That seems fair. That's enough. You know. In some cases today, that ratio is 400 to 1. So under this resolution, where they kind of picked the number out of the hat, you know, 200 to 1, the CEO of a company where the average non-supervisory employee makes, say, $35,000, would be limited to $14 million annual total compensation. Just for reference, minimum wage is still under $12,000 annually. Maybe you read that article in last Sunday's News and Observer about Patsy Sechrest, the 58-year-old lady who works at Hardee's in Archdale, North Carolina, for $8.50 an hour. She had hoped to be retired, but as she said in the article, all the money I had saved for when I get ready to retire is up yonder now at the hospital and the doctors. She had triple bypass surgery a few years ago. Her share of that cost was $3,800, but she needs to work for the medical benefits, and so she works for $8.50 an hour at Hardee's. About $20,000 a year with overtime, basically to pay for her prescriptions. She takes four different prescriptions every day, but still her back aches like a toothache, but still she labors on. What's the right thing to do for the Patty Sechrests of the world and the ones in worse shape than she? What is just and fair? What's the compassionate thing to do? Will we do the most good working individually? Or collectively as a church? Or do we need to do what we New Hope Presbyterians are proposing and try to make our economic system a bit more just? As the prophet Amos says, we will be held responsible for how we treat the widows and the poor and the needy and the sick. What's the right thing for us to do for that widow who's down to her last two coins? It might involve challenging the way our government allocates tax dollars for services to the poor, the homeless, the sick, the mentally ill. Or it might involve mobilizing our resources to support such charitable efforts as the Healing Place, the Raleigh Rescue Mission, or Harriet's House. We, like Jesus, are against social injustice. Although, in this particular story, what makes the scribes' actions so heinous is they're doing what they do in the name of God. This is what God wants you to do. I think that's why some of the TV evangelists grated on us so badly. They were distorting God's word for their own personal profit. Jim and Tammy in their heyday told your grandma to send them some money so they could feed this starving little child in wherever and keep the television ministry going. I hate the fact they called it a ministry. You know, that word implies you're doing something to help someone, not to do something to them. A guy I worked with at WRL-TV went to visit their TV studios back in the PTL heyday, and he said they had the best camera, the best switcher, the best special effects generator, and they had a spare one just like it over in the corner, the best money could buy. And, of course, remember the gold plumbing fixtures at the Baker Mansion. As Louis Grizzard said, those TV evangelists all tell you to send your money to God, but they give you their address. I always feel a lot more comfortable about investing in my church or something local like the Healing Place where I can keep an eye on how the money is invested. So how will God help the widow? I believe God will. But as Teresa of Avila once said, God has no hands on earth but ours. So God will find a pair of human hands to give that woman a sandwich. Maybe they saw what she did in the church, or maybe just saw a hungry person in need and reached out. Maybe God has found an extra set of hands here today, or a new set of eyes that'll be looking around a bit more carefully, more with more peripheral vision, not distracted by what the rich and... Because God has no hands but ours, no eyes but ours, no feet but ours to tend to that widow. but God will care for her. And blessed be the hands that God chooses to use. Hands blessed in the joy of giving. Giving because of your gratitude to God. Giving because you have put your full trust in God. You have put your faith in God's faithfulness to you. I hope each of us leaves here today humming to ourselves, "If thou but trust in God to guide thee, with hopeful heart through all thy ways, do thine own part faithfully, trust the rich promises of grace."
In response to God's word, let's stand and say what we believe as we say together the words from a brief statement of faith that are printed in the bulletin. We trust in God who created the world good and makes everyone equally in God's image, male and female, of every race and people, to live as one community. But we rebel against God. We violate the image of God in others and ourselves. We accept lies as truth. We exploit neighbor and nature and threaten death to the planet entrusted to our care. We deserve God's condemnation.
In God asks justice and mercy to redeem creation.
Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ of the covenant. Like a mother who will not forsake her nursing child, like a father who runs to welcome the prodigal home, God is faithful still. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Turn to God for a time of prayer. Let us remember the following pastoral concerns. Beth Richardson is a patient at Wake Med. Carol Morgan is at Duke. And we extend our sympathy to the family of Mildred Harmon, who died on Monday, and the service was held on Wednesday with Bob Inskeep officiating. We also extend our sympathy to Catherine Hardee, whose sister, Carla Bradshaw Hayes, died this morning, and Catherine has gone to Richmond to be with the family. Let us pray. God of the ages, we come before you this day with hearts filled with thanksgiving and praise. You have blessed us with a rich harvest and manifold gifts. Help us to be aware of our abundance and to share it with others. We thank you for this church, for the wonderful people here, for the generosity and caring, the willingness to serve others and to become involved in the various ministries. We thank you that we all have gifts and resources to share and are called to do so. May they be used to empower our ministry in your name, here and abroad. We pray your blessing on this church in a time of transition, on the work of the pastor nominating committee, the leadership of the session, diaconate, and all the committees. We thank you for Christian education leaders, for our choir and music leaders, for our church staff, and all those who carry on the work of this church. We pray your blessing on Leighton Mosey and his wife Harriet as they move to Raleigh and as he begins his work here this week. Be especially with those who are sick or suffering in any way, who grieve the loss of loved ones, who find the challenges of aging or illness overwhelming, who struggle with financial or emotional worries. Help us to truly be your people at work, serving you faithfully, so that all that we do may bring honor and glory to your name. Give comfort and guidance to those with great need. And hear those prayers that are tucked away in the silent places of our hearts as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now present unto God our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Generous God, you have blessed us in so many ways, and we are thankful for your gifts. Please take these gifts, gifts of our resources and gifts of the heart, and use them to help alleviate pain and suffering, hunger and thirst, and to spread the good news of Jesus Christ to all people. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hymn charges us, do your own part faithfully, trust the rich promises of grace, so shall they be fulfilled in you. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the continuing presence of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
church home, we invite you to join with us in Christian discipleship. We've been at this location since 1816, a strong, vibrant downtown church. We did a survey about 2 months ago and found that the average member travels 10.5 miles from all over Wake County and the counties beyond. So we're glad for the vitality of this congregation made up of members, and we invite you to join with us in Christian ministry. There's a place to check on the friendship page. You're interested in receiving information or in receiving a visit. If you'd like to speak with someone at the close of the service, there will be an officer, an elder in this room to my right, who will talk with you about how one does become a member of First Presbyterian Church. We're also a Stephen Ministry congregation, and there will be a representative of the Stephen Ministry program in this room as well. If you have a concern to share, if you'd like to arrange an appointment, this individual will receive that invitation and will assist. In the pew racks also is a lavender card. We have a group of individuals who engage in the ministry of intercessory prayer. If you have a prayer concern about yourself or a member of the family or a friend, fill that card out. You may place it in the offering plate, or if you feel it's confidential, you may place it in one of the boxes in the vestibules as you enter the sanctuary area. Again, we're glad that you're here. At the close of the service, we have coffee and fellowship in the Balkan Parlor. I say that, the coffee, because sometimes I say coffee. All the coffee has been drunk before we get there. So we trust there will be coffee. I know there will be fellowship, and we trust there will be coffee as well. As a New Orleanian, I like coffee any hour of the day, and I trust that there will be coffee in the Balkan Parlor. This past Wednesday at our session meeting, the session acted upon a recommendation with regret but with appreciation for the years of service of a staff member, and it accepted the resignation of Angela Marie Cook as associate pastor for youth and young adults so that she could enter graduate school for a PhD program where she's been accepted at Claremont University in California. And a letter will be going out from George Shackelford and the personnel committee, and with information as to how we will celebrate Angela's years with us, very important years, and how we can respond accordingly. Angela's embarrassed about this announcement, because she has never done this before. This is her first congregation she has served since graduating from seminary, but things will unfold, and we'll have an opportunity to say thank you to Angela for over 4 years of ministry with us. Significant time in the life of our congregation. Our preacher of the morning is Marnie Crumpler, who holds the William Bennett Chaplaincy Chair, funded by Perry Sloan of Durham, Trinity Avenue Presbyterian Church. Dr. Bennett served that congregation for over 40 years, and that was his only pastorate. Came out of graduate school and served that congregation, and so the chaplaincy chair was established, and Marnie Crumpler is the first one to occupy that chair as the chaplain. She is also an instructor in biblical studies at the college. She's a graduate of Princeton, served in Houston area as on staff of First Presbyterian Church, married a Baptist minister, and so they're really an ecumenical family, and we're glad that she is at Peace College and is with us this Sunday. We're also glad for all the students who are here, liturgists, those singing, Professors Jim Smith and Jenny Vance, Lily Stoke, who was our substitute student who led in prayer, and others of you who are here connected with the college. We are glad that you are here. We're also pleased that Laura Carpenter Bingham is here as president of Peace. Warren, her husband, is somewhere. Here he is. He was on the other side of the first service, sitting in front, and we're glad that Warren is here with Laura. At this time, Laura brings words of greeting on behalf of the college.
Good morning to all. Earlier, I acknowledged Angela's moving on for very good reason, I believe, but I told her that she follows another wonderful woman of the triangle to the Claremont McKenna Colleges. The former dean and the first woman dean of the law school at Duke, it has just become in the last 2 or 3 months the new president of Claremont McKenna. So we know that we send now another strong woman to the West Coast, and we hope one day she comes back east, perhaps to First Presbyterian, perhaps to Peace College. So congratulations to you, Angela. I do want to acknowledge Warren in that this is the culmination of our annual alumni weekend at the college, and we had a grand occasion. We kicked off the weekend with an exclusive visit, in fact, to the Rodin exhibit at the Museum of Art. And yesterday at noon, the class of 1950, who were celebrating their 50th anniversary, their 50th reunion at Peace, adopted Warren Bingham as their mascot. I dare say there's been any presidential spouse to be included in that esteemed role, but I think he accepted that with great joy. And they also said they would appreciate it if he did not hook up with any other classes in future years. So we'll see how that stands over time. Indeed, we are honored to be here and pleased to be here. I see Garrett and Sue Briggs in the audience, and Garrett and Sue, wonderful to see you. All of those on behalf of First Presbyterian and Peace College, we do appreciate on an annual and monthly and weekly and sometimes daily basis the ways in which First Presbyterian and Peace join together in our ministry. Today we had Susan Davis carry the mace down. This is a mace that was given by this congregation for the occasion of my installation this time last year. It was its inaugural use for the college, and we are delighted to have the mace. In its inaugural journey, however, Ed Hipp and Bill Ross and Coo Brown carried it on behalf of First Presbyterian, and that was a wonderful sight, Ed, and just an occasion that we all shall remember well in our minds for many years to come. I want to acknowledge Jim Smith and Jenny Vance, who, of course, are our wonderful music professors and work so closely with our chamber singers and our choir. You will hear some of their talents this morning. In fact, the anthem that they'll be singing, Living in a Holy City, was a piece especially commissioned for our chamber singers on the occasion of the inauguration last year. It is written by a composer who is Canadian but moved to Belfast, Ireland, and it is a song of freedom, and you will hear that in the words of Living in a Holy City. I'd like to invite all of those associated with Peace College on our Board of Trustees, our Foundation Board, our Board of Visitors, alumni, parents, students, all of us who have a role at Peace College to please stand now so we can acknowledge jointly the community of peace that we enjoy. And I want you to stay standing for a moment as I announce a very special occasion that took place yesterday at our annual meeting of the Alumni Association. Olive Worth has served both this church and Peace College for 75 years. She graduated from Peace in 1925, returned to teach at Peace not just once but twice, and of course I think was the power behind all those men who gathered in the late 1950s and early 1960s to make sure that Peace remained in Raleigh and remained as a vital mission of the downtown Raleigh area. Yesterday, the Board of Trustees, represented by Sherry Worth, our chair of the board, bestowed upon Olive Worth the highest honor that we have at the college, and it is the William Peace Medallion for her 75 years of service as Olive celebrated her 75th anniversary at Peace College. So, Olive, this morning, Koo said, let's give her a hand, and we want to do that. I'm known to cry a bit at the podium when there's something traditional happening at Peace because I'm an alumna of Peace, so I imagine and experience these feelings again as I did as a student, and I just broke down for many minutes while Olive was being bestowed this honor. But she is truly a daily inspiration for me and for all of us, and I think is symbolic of the wonderful tie between First Presbyterian and Peace College. Thank you for allowing us to be with you today.
Thank you. Shall we pray? Dear God, I just thank you for bringing us here together to fellowship together one more time in your house. I ask that you bring an understanding to your word, Lord, that we may hide it in our hearts. Amen. I'll be reading for you today chapter 52, verses 1 through 10. Awake, awake, O Zion, clothe yourselves with strength. Put on your garments of splendor, O Jerusalem, the holy city. The uncircumcised and defiled will not enter you again. Shake off your dust, rise up, sit enthroned, O Jerusalem. Free yourselves from the chains on your neck, O captive daughter of Zion. For this is what the Lord says. You were sold for nothing, and without money you will be redeemed. For this is what the sovereign Lord says. At first my people went down to Egypt to live. Lately, Assyria has oppressed them. And now, what do I have here, declares the Lord. For my people have been taken away for nothing, and those who rule them mock, declares the Lord. And all day long my name is constantly blasphemed. Therefore my people will know my name. Therefore in that day they will know that it is I who foretold it. Yes, it is I. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy. When the Lord returns to Zion, they will see it with their own eyes. Burst into songs of joy together, your ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. This is the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God.
The scripture reading today is from 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. Life appeared. We have seen it and testify to it. We proclaim it to you, the eternal life, which was with us, the Father, and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what you have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by faith. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Let me say again what our president has already said. We are delighted to be here with you. I am thankful to God for the testimony and the witness of this church, and I'm grateful for the partnership that the college and this church have shared, and look forward to building on that heritage and looking into a bright future. You see our future, they just sang to you, and we appreciate our partnership with you that helps what women become at Peace College. I invite you to turn to the Gospel of John as we look at Scripture this second Sunday after Easter. John chapter 20. We'll be reading, beginning in verse 19, and we'll begin reading about Jesus's one of his first appearances to his disciples. Again, John chapter 20, beginning in verse 19. Hear the word of God. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite you to join me in prayer. Now, God, we ask that you would bring your word and make it our word, that we might be hearers, but not simply hearers, but doers. And may all this happen, God, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we pray it in the name of our risen Lord, even Jesus Christ. Amen. I was only 9 years old, and I was a committed tomboy. My 7-year-old brother, Trip, and I were all over our neighborhood playing freeze tag, ghost in the graveyard, and of course, baseball. But this particularly muggy summer afternoon in Atlanta found us participating in our favorite pastime, doing what our parents told us not to do. My mom and dad had warned us over and over again not to climb in our neighbor's trees. They didn't want us there, our neighbors or our parents. And really, the trees weren't big enough to hold two rambunctious kids. But we were climbing anyway, this time at the tree at the bottom of the driveway right next to the street. Everything was fine. We were having a great time until, you guessed it, snap. In the course of 5 seconds, our grade school worlds were shattered. The fall scared us, but fear focused on what might happen to us when the broken limbs were discovered. So we did the only thing we could. We ran. That evening, Dad came home from work and straight into the den. What happened next door? Trip and I looked at each other, but tried to stay busy and away from Dad, close to the TV. He asked again, "What happened next door?" This time I couldn't take it, and I buckled, and I told him the truth between loud, heavy sobs. Dad said he was really sorry, but we had disobeyed, and we could live with that. But his next words terrified us. "You'll have to go next door and tell Mr. and Mrs. Jones what you did." He might as well have banished us to Alcatraz. We saw no hope. At different ages and at different times in our lives, we experience circumstances that seem to us hopeless. whether owning up to the destruction of a neighbor's tree, failing a test, not getting into the college of our choice, being bound by addiction, or watching a spouse or a child or someone we love through a difficult time. Did you hear the passage that Shanae read for us a few moments ago? You can hear and you can even feel the utter hopelessness of Isaiah's circumstance. The writer gives us a little Old Testament 101 lesson and refreshes us of the past. He reminds us of the Egyptian bondage, of the Assyrian oppression, and of the Babylonian captivity. Yet the writer chooses to place all this seemingly hopelessness situations in a surprising context. He tells of all the difficult and troubling times in terms of the future day of divine revelation and salvation. The familiar words that Paul uses again in Romans ring out hope. How beautiful are the feet of him who brings good tidings, who publishes peace, who brings good tidings of good, who promises salvation, and who boldly claims, "Your God reigns." Yes, there's a lot of bad news, but yes, there is bad news. Friday has come. Jesus has died painfully on a cross, but Sunday has also come. This Sunday after Easter, Christians around the world are again proclaiming that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. The beautiful feet of our own Lord Jesus have conquered death and hell and have loudly trumpeted a way for us to know God. But hang on for a moment. Don't get too excited. Don't read too far ahead, though you know the ending. I invite you this morning to linger with me with the disciples in Jerusalem. These fearless and faithful followers are hiding out behind a locked door. Easter Sunday has come and is now ending, but the disciples are still fearful. Mary told them she had seen Jesus. Wouldn't you have been? The crucifixion had been. They had run and deserted Jesus. They were afraid that they were next. Jesus was gone. They had seen him die. They had seen his broken and lifeless body. But suddenly, in the midst of their fear, Jesus appears. He offers them peace, not once, but twice. And with his appearance, the reality of the resurrection is clear. They have hope. They see his hands and his feet, and they know that he is their risen Lord. It's an absolute reversal for the disciples. Jesus had gone from death to life, and the disciples now can go from fear to hope. But before this appearance and the reality of the resurrection, things had seemed hopeless. First, the disciples felt that Christ himself had failed them. The time which they had given in following Jesus seemed worthless. The promises he had made seemed unkept. Each of them had given up so much to follow Jesus, careers, families, and more. And now where were they? But locked up, afraid for their lives. They were disillusioned and in despair. Second, the disciples knew they had failed Jesus. They each had guilty consciences. Think about Peter. He had promised he would always be faithful. No matter what. But his promises got him nowhere. In spite of all those big words and big promises, Peter had denied Christ not once, not twice, but three times. All the disciples had fled when Jesus had been arrested and had feared for themselves. Their self-respect was gone. They had been unloyal to the one they had pledged loyalty to. Then Jesus enters into their presence, and his appearance stamps reality into his lordship. The presence of Jesus stamps wrong on their doubts. The disciples' doubts of Jesus failing them had been wrong. You see, the disciples had not understood that it had taken the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus' life to change their lives forever. They didn't understand the stakes that were raised as he conquered death and hell, and as he reconciled all of humanity, including them, to God. Their doubts of Christ had been wrong, but they didn't understand it until Jesus showed himself and his scars to add to the testimony of Mary of his resurrection. Now they had no doubts about his lordship. But they were also wrong in what they assumed about themselves. Their doubts about their puny discipleship and following after Jesus were overturned. In his appearance, he affirms them again that he trusts them and that he has called them to do his work in the world. He had not made a mistake when he had called them from their fishing boats and their tax booths and their families. They were, and they would continue to be, an integral part of God's ministry in the world as they spread the good news everywhere. They have been forgiven and chosen to do God's work. Many of you probably remember the inspiring movie, The Mission. The movie opens up with a very powerful scene. It opens up with scenes of the central character, Espinosa, enslaving the Guarani people. When he returns from one of his slave trips, he discovers that his brother has fallen in love with his girlfriend, and he eventually kills his brother in a duel. After the duel, Espinosa is extremely remorseful because he knows that he really loved his brother. He is consumed with depression, and he locks himself in a cell at a local mission where he neither eats nor cares for himself. He has condemned himself to hell. He is without hope. Weeks later, a priest comes back from a mission which has been ministering to the peoples that Espinosa was enslaving. The priest calls on Espinosa, and Espinosa again laments that he is without hope. He says, "There's no way of forgiving me. I am unforgivable." But the priest continues and pushes. He tells him that he has to try, and for his penance, he is to go back with the priest to the Guarani mission. Along the way, as part of his penance, he must carry his brother's armor through the terrible native landscape. The climax comes when, at the top of a very difficult hill, the priest and Espinosa meet some Guarani people who recognize the slave trader, Espinosa. But instead of murdering him, they see his face and they withdraw the knife. Rather than his throat, the Guarani man cuts the rope which binds the armor to Espinosa. The burden of the armor literally and the blood guilt figuratively are gone. Just as Espinosa's burden was lifted and his life was fundamentally restored, the disciples' lives are restored by the appearance of Jesus. God's love, God's power, God's grace in Jesus covered their need and their weakness and failures, and restored hope. Did you notice the phrase that Jesus repeats? Peace be with you. Clearly, Jesus speaks and personifies peace. Peace that overshadows their immediate fears, and peace that overshadows their not so immediate fears of their eventual death. But on this Peace Sunday, I want to suggest to you a different spin. Every Sunday, this church celebrates the resurrection. It proclaims Christ's death and rising from the dead. But on this Sunday, it is my prayer that you will celebrate our partnership in a ministry of peace because of that resurrection. A ministry that empowers women to use their gifts and talents to serve God. A ministry that calls women to be all that God has intended them to be. A ministry that boldly and unashamedly recognizes its Christian heritage. What a beautiful symbol it was a few moments ago of this partnership. A peace alum bringing her daughter Karen to the covenant waters of baptism. What a great day for this child of the covenant to be celebrated. I guess peace, as Ed already alluded to, will get its chance to make its mark on her in the year 2018. Something like that. I guess I'll have to get my sermons ready now. God has empowered Peace College and First Presbyterian Church of Raleigh to do a very important ministry. The text continues, and Jesus further empowers the disciples to do ministry. He does some interesting things. He breathes on them and tells them that like the Father sent him, so Jesus is sending the disciples. Their experiences have made them ready to know God and to serve God in more committed ways. And as we know, as church history tells us, they're going to need all the strength and spirit-given courage that God will give, because they're going to encounter hostile audiences to the gospel and hostile governments, people who will eventually take their lives. My question for you this morning is, are you in the room with those disciples? Are you afraid and fearful? I believe it's still so easy to lock the door and throw away the alarm code. It's easy for us to believe that God has failed us and that Jesus has forgotten us. We hide behind the doors of our own circumstances from the things which frighten us. Yet, can it be that our situations are preparing us for new commitment? God can use our failures. He can forgive us and empower us. So has Jesus Christ appeared to us behind the closed doors of our life? Do you see the wounds in his side, on his hands, and in his feet? Do you feel the love which Christ has extended to you? My friends, in the resurrection, Jesus has indeed made an appearance and has an impact on our lives through every struggle and through every joy. I don't know about you, but I'm a little relieved. I know that Christ has not failed me, even though I daily fail him. But his resurrection is real. So even if it appears that I would be of no use to God, the reality is that Christ's love, Christ's resurrected self, reinstates me. He chooses each of us to be a part of his ministry, to be those beautiful feet, to be writers alongside the writer of 1 John, to write with our lives letters of testimony on the faithfulness and love of God. No, we don't go in our own strength, but we go empowered by God, sent and then given the strength to go. The Jesuit father, Luis Espinal, was assassinated on March 22, 1980, in La Paz, Bolivia, by paramilitary forces. And right before his death, he wrote this meditation, which I think speaks so powerfully of the power that we have. This is what he says. There are Christians who have hysterical reactions as if the world would have slipped out of God's hands. They act violently as if they were risking everything. But we believe in history. The world is not a roll of the dice going towards chaos. A new world has begun to happen since Christ has risen. Jesus Christ, we rejoice in your definitive triumph. With our bodies still in the breach and souls in tension, we cry out our first hurrah till eternity unfolds itself. Your sorrow now has passed. Your enemies have failed. You are a definitive smile for humankind. What matter the wait now for us? We accept the struggle and the death because you, our love, will not die. We march behind you on the road to the future. You are with us, and you are our immortality. Take away the sadness from our faces. We are not in a game of chance. You have the last word. You know, in seminary, one of the first rules that you were taught about in studying scripture was read a passage in its context. So if you were to keep reading as we did, you would find the context and the purpose for the entire gospel. John gives us his purpose for his writing at the end of chapter 20. He says, "These words are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." the reality of the resurrection of our Lord occurred that we may all trust Jesus as the Christ, and that we may have life in his name. I heard a funny story that tells about one New Year's Day in the Tournament of Roses. It was the parade, the famous parade, and a beautiful float suddenly sputtered and quit. It was out of gas. The whole parade was held up so someone could run and go get a can of gas. The funny thing was that this float represented the Standard Oil Company. With its vast oil resources, its truck was out of gas. My friends, we have at our fingertips the power, the hope, and the peace of Christ. May we use it. May Peace College and First Presbyterian Church in Raleigh be empowered to go and boldly proclaim the peace that is found only in Christ through the power of his resurrection. Amen. As a response to God's word, I invite you to stand and say with me what we believe, the Apostles' Creed. Please stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you've given to us. Thank you for our friends, our families, our loved ones. Thank you for this day and the chance that we have to worship together. We ask for your blessing, Lord, as we head into the new week. And with all the turmoil going on in the world, guide and protect us. Help us to make the right decisions. And now we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Now let us bring forth our tithes and offerings.
voices up to mark the place we stand, and every step that you take is a promised land. When you are heading for a holy city, alleluia, 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 holy city, alleluia, 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 alleluia,
alleluia,
alleluia, alleluia, alleluia, holy city.
It is such a privilege to worship you with our tithes and offerings. You've given us so much. Your provision is more enormous than we can even imagine. Lord, we humbly recognize that everything we have belongs to you. So in obedience to your word and in deep gratitude, we give a portion of ourselves back to you. May these gifts make a difference for your kingdom in this city and around this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Now sing with us hymn number 371.
Thank you.
peace be with you. And that those words will empower you by the power of the Holy Spirit through the resurrected Lord to lift high the cross wherever you might be. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.
Amen.